Welcome again to the program into the chambers of the King. And today we are going to continue on what we started last week. We've been looking at, 2 weeks ago, we've been looking at the Word and how to meditate on the Word, because the Bible says that if we meditate on the Word, we are going to prosper. And so as we are looking at some of the scriptures like that, John 2, it says, "Beloved, I pray that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers." And so today we are going, there's that where your soul needs to prosper, but also your spirit needs to prosper. Because when we are looking at 1 Thessalonians 5:23, the Bible says, "May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord." And so if God is sanctifying us completely, He's sanctifying the three parts: our spirit, our soul, and our body. So our spirit, the work has been done. Like we took some time 2 weeks ago to see that we have been born from above, and we are no longer living souls, but we are life-giving spirits. As Jesus was, so are we in this world. And is so are we in this world. And so if we are life-giving spirits, then what is it that we need to be sanctified, and what do we need to do on that part of who we really are? And so our spirit, we need to mature, because if we do not mature, that means that we would be entrusted. The whole thing of being a Christian, because if it was just being a Christian and going to heaven is good, to spend eternity with God, but that is not it. God wants us to learn how to advance his kingdom, how to rule and reign, and also, yes, how to advance his kingdom, how to advance his government here on the earth. And so for us to be able to do that, we need to be ambassadors. And for us to become ambassadors, who are the representatives of the kingdom of God, then there is a portion for us to do, which is maturing. And so today we are going to look at that, like what is really maturing? How do we know if we are mature? Because the Bible says in the book of Galatians 4, that even if you are, I'm just paraphrasing, even if you are a son, so that means that you have received inheritance. You are joint heir with Jesus Christ, but you are heirs of God. So you have that inheritance with you. And we also looked at the book of Peter, 2 Peter, that God has given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. And so even if you have the divine nature inside of you, if we do not mature, that means that, as it says right there in Galatians 4:1, we'll be like servants, we'll be like slaves, because our inheritance will be with the guardians until we are able to mature. And so what are some of the ways that we can know that we are maturing? And so we're going to use different scriptures, but we see this in John 15, when we are looking at the vine, Jesus being the vine and us being the branches and the Father being the vine dresser. So that those are some of the ways that we mature, where the Father comes and prunes and removes some things from us, even if we were bearing fruit, so that we can bear more fruit. So we have to accept that process of maturing and being discipled by God. Then the other scripture that we are going to look at is Ephesians 4:11-16. And in Ephesians 4, he says that he himself gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. So there's the equipping where you need to be equipped. And then for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we come into the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And then it goes on to say that we should no longer be children. So this is what we are looking at. Because in the Bible, when the Bible says we are sons, that word son, it's not always son like a mature son. There is the who, when you're looking at the Greek, there's different there's different names for the son. So there's the, like here, it's children. Then there's the, like, the teenage son. Then there's the mature son. So we see this where there's a progressive growth. And just like in the normal way, you cannot entrust you 9-year-old with the responsibility of learning your business. Why? Because even if the child is your son, and maybe that is the only child you have, so you know that all the inheritance you have is going to go to him, and maybe you have even established a trust so that the inheritance, you have written a will so that the inheritance already belongs to him. You can't give it to him yet because he has not matured. You can't give it to him to manage. And it is the same thing with the kingdom of God. It says first the natural, then the spiritual. And so we don't want to be children tossed to and from and carried by every wind of doctrine, by trickery of men, in cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. Verse 15, it says, but speaking truth in love may grow up in all things into him who is head, who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body is joined together, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causing growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. And so we know this symbolism that Paul is using here in the book of Ephesians. We also see it in the book of Colossians, where it says like we are like a body. And so some people are like the eye, some people are the hand. So we are the body of Christ. So that means that if you do not mature, that means that you cannot supply what it is that you want to supply. So the body is not actually going to grow. Most of the time we are looking at the pastors as the ones that are just supposed to mature and mature us. But now we are going to look at some of the signs of of immaturity or areas that we need to mature in. And so that is the next part. I'm going to look at 12 things. And how can you know if you are not mature? Remember, in your spirit, he who is joined with the Lord is one spirit with the Lord. So in your spirit right now, your spirit and the spirit of the Lord is one. So there's that unity, there's that oneness. But then we see that we said in our soul, we need to be transformed. And so sometimes when you see people are whining, complaining, there's slander, there's backbiting, there's contention, gossip, divisions, jealousy, all these are signs of immaturity. And there are so many of them. And so we're going to look at 12 of them, maybe more. And some of them this week, and then some of them next week. So from that scripture, but why do we need to mature? On one side, there's that scripture in Luke 2:52, and the Bible says Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. And that word stature is maturity. And so for you to increase in wisdom, because we need more wisdom to be able to do what it is that we need to do. For us to increase in wisdom, we need to increase in wisdom, and we also need to increase in stature, which is in maturity. But so let's look at some of the areas. And one of the people that I was looking at is Solomon. Because when you look at Solomon, the first years of his life after King David died, and he handed him the assignment that he needed to do. And so we see Solomon building the temple. Solomon, he was so busy. And then we see him dedicating this temple, and God coming twice and speaking to him. But later on, the Bible says that Solomon did what was despicable, which God had said do not do. And so he married so many foreign women that started driving him away from God. And so once there was that driving away from God, the question I usually ask is, was there nobody to come and tell him that, Solomon, the direction you are going is not light? Because we see with King David, when even when he sinned, Prophet Nathan was able to come. He used Proverbs and stuff, but he was able to actually come and speak to him. So it is good to have people speaking into your life in this journey of maturing, because the Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. And so you need some people speaking into your life for you to actually, because there can be some blind spots as we walk in this journey. So the first sign of immaturity, we see it right there. It is being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. And so that one is just self-explanatory. It's just like now, if I ask you, what do you believe as a Christian? What is your core belief? Not what your church believes, not what it is that you have heard other people talk about, but have you taken time in the Word of God to tell me on how you believe? What do you believe about healing? What do you believe about grace? What do you believe about mercy? What do you believe about the different things, salvation and evangelism? What is it that you believe? And so if we come to that place where you must have your core belief system, because like we looked at last time, that we are not just supposed to believe these things, we are supposed to teach it. And so you can't teach something. You can tell people what you know, but for them to actually be transformed, you have to spend time in the Word. That's what we are calling meditating. You spend time so much in the Word, meditating on the Word, until it becomes part of who you are, and that's the only way that you're able to release it to somebody else. And so that's what I'm saying. What do you believe? So whenever there's problems, are you able to just go to the Word of God and say the solution to this problem is here and here? Or are you tossed to by every wind of doctrine? Let's say you are listening to the news, and even now there's some prophecies that come, and some prophet will say, oh no, the end of time is here, the blood moon, the blue moon, this moon. And then are you tossed to and fro, or do you have a stable foundation? So that is a sign of maturity. So examine yourself, and you will know where you stand on that. The other one is, are you carried about by every wind of doctrine? So that is the second one we see there in the book of Ephesians. So what is the wind of doctrine? Being carried about by every wind of doctrine. Let me give you an example. You know, like now, there's a way that I can teach a message, and just so that I can get feedback. And so I'll come and tell you, oh, you be blessed. You, and I'm not telling you that for you to actually prosper, you need to. There's some good pain. There's some constructive pain. There's some things that you need to do. You need to discipline yourself. You need to spend time in the Word for you to actually prosper. And instead of just moving, you know, most people are chasing miracles. And for a miracle to happen, there has to be a crisis. So you have to be moving from crisis to crisis instead of moving in the blessing. And so if I come and tell you, for you to move in a blessing, it won't start like so big. It is a small here, then it keeps growing. You know, like when you plant crops, and then they are small, then they keep growing, then they keep growing until they bear fruit. Then you take those fruits. Some of them become food for you. Some of them become seed. And so that's the kingdom of God. That's how it is supposed to operate. And so the easiest example I could find is if you have a child who is not, if you have a child, and you have a child, and you come, and you have this nice, beautiful car, and then you come and show it to the child, and the child, you come and buy the child this very expensive book or computer, something that is very, very valuable, and you come and give it to the child. It is a quiet, very expensive laptop. You just come and bring it to the child. What will the child do with it? Even if they are 10, what will they do? They'll look at it, they'll wonder, maybe they'll look at it and play games with your car. They don't know what to do. Maybe if it has things that they can press, they'll press on it. And then the same child, you come and bring them a toy that makes a lot of noise. It is $10 and it makes so much noise. What will the child do? The child will start running after that car. And it is the same thing in the kingdom of God. Most of us, if this is a sign, we are looking at the sign of immaturity. And so some of us just want that place where there's so much noise. Just somebody who will keep telling you, you don't have to do anything. You just be blessed. And then we make this new year resolutions at the beginning of the year. We just tell you, oh, you're going to be blessed. Nothing on your part. There's nothing you need to do. You just need to confess this, and you confess and you receive. And we know that is not true. That is a toy that is making so much noise. And so sometimes you have that. Some people come and they are teaching you the depth of the word, but you don't have time to listen to that. And then so that is a sign that you need to grow, you need to mature. And so the other thing, so for you to mature, actually to become the disciple of God. And so so listen and visit the word and spend time and be committed. And don't follow the crowd of offense, follow the crowd of glory. Because some people get offended and leave. So that's what carried by every weed of doctrine. So we are accusing this person, so you follow them. Then the other one is Hebrews, from Hebrews 5:11-14, you become dull of hearing. So what is dull of hearing? That word dull in Greek means sluggish or lazy, or sometimes, so you don't seem to listen. Because the Bible says, to him who has, more will be given. And so if you have, you'll be given more. And to him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. And so there's that where if you, and the Bible says, be careful how you hear. So there's a way that you can choose to hear. So you could, if you humble yourself and listen, and you are not dull in your spiritual hearing and achieving spiritual insight, so you must take time. There has to be time taken slowly by slowly. Don't expect it always, like we are expecting even the word. We can't dedicate a whole year to go in the word and start meditating on the word every day. We just want one thing, one time, like fast food. I said, no, it is not like that. And so the more we practice being able to hear what God is saying to us, the more we listen to actually hear, then we go with that will be a sign that we are maturing. And then there's this where some people, it's still the same, dull of hearing. Some people position themselves, every time they go even to the church or they are listening to someone, they position themselves as if they know already what the person is saying, or they know more than the person who is saying something. And so, and then they will sometimes find something wrong to discredit what the person is saying, trying to bring, so the attention comes back to them. Remember, all of us are not perfect. All of us are studying the word, but you have to listen to hear. And so this is, sometimes you see this with the teenagers, a parent and a teenager. And so you are trying to help them with something, and you bring up something about their character flaw. And then when you bring up something about their character flaw, like you tell somebody, you need to be attending the Bible study in the church. You need to be reading the word. And then they look for something to justify, something that they will accuse you of. So instead of hearing what you are saying, they bring it back. So those are signs of immaturity. You can't justify your character flaw by pointing a character flaw in me. So just listen to hear. So that is the other one. And remember, we are all growing in this. Then the other one is you need to be taught instead of teaching yourself and others. Oh, this one, I can go to so many people that say they are Christians. You know, like a child, remember we are looking at maturity. And the Bible says it's the natural first. So just think about your natural child. So you have a child and you come and feed them. And when they are a child, when they are a few days old, when they are 2 years old, you come and feed them. You even force feed them. You know, like when you come and you put that food in their mouth and then they spit it all back at you. You don't say, oh, no, I'm not going to feed you until you eat. No, you take the food back again with a spoon. You feed them again. They spit it back at you because they are a child. So at that time, that is their age. They are a child. But now when it comes to the time that they grow up, maybe they are 15, 20, 30 years old. When they are 30 years old, you don't come with a spoon and try to feed them. If they say they don't want to eat, you are like, okay, that's good. Stuff. You will tell them, here's the food. And so that's the same thing. But it's not the same in the church. You will find people that have been saved for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. And when you tell them to take the word and lead, or when you teach something that they have never had, they never take time to feed themselves. They always expect to be fed. And so there's that. It has to be both ways. You be fed, but also take time to feed yourself. Force feeding is only for the babies. You must step back and start taking time with the word yourself. So that would be a sign of maturity. Remember, we are looking at areas where we need to mature, because we said that if you're a child, and even if God loves you so much, and he has given you all things that pertain to life and godliness, where you have become a joint heir with Jesus Christ and an heir of God, you do not receive the inheritance until you mature. And so these are some of the signs of immaturity. So ask yourself, when is the last time that you took the word by yourself, and or maybe what you had being taught, and you started learning yourself? And so sometimes when you start, maybe even when these people are in the church, they start telling the pastor, I don't believe that way. I disagree with that. I was not taught that way. So instead of going more like, you know, like what the Bible says about the Bereans. The Bible says the Bereans were more noble than their brothers, because whatever they had taught, they went back and they researched from the word to see if these things were so. Because Paul was teaching them something that they had never heard. Right now, everybody wants to be taught only what they have heard. You know, I keep saying, revelation is like our phones. You have phones or computers. Do you know the phone you had at 5 years ago, 10 years ago, is not the same phone that you have? There has been upgrades on the technology. But in the world, we don't look for new revelation that God is giving us. We assume that everything that would ever have been discovered in the world has been discovered by our denomination. So I keep saying, if the Bible says something contrary to what you believe, you do not change the Bible. You change your belief system. And so that is a sign of maturity. And so don't stick by what, oh, my denomination says this. And so this is what our denomination believes. No, what does the Bible say? Because we said that you have to come and learn and also come to the knowledge of truth. So that is the sign of maturity. And then it says that place in the Hebrews, it says that I had to give you milk, not meat. You cannot handle the weightier matters of the kingdom. Not just hearing the simple things, but also harder things. So we must be open to that. To hear the harder things of God. Like today, this message is not a message, it's not as difficult, but it's not a message that will make the church shout and yell and run around the building. Because the responsibility of maturity is being placed back upon you. And so if the responsibility of maturity is being placed back upon you, then you need to embrace it. You need to receive it. And so that is, so those are some of the things. So mature. What is the last time that you didn't just stay on the milk of the word? That you didn't just react when situations come upon you. You just react instead of looking at a problem or a crisis and now going back and finding the solution that is in the word. And so next time we are going to continue on this topic of maturing. But I hope you got something that for you, for us to actually receive an inheritance, we need to mature. God bless you, and we'll continue from here next week.